ஃபேஸ்புக் லைவ்
அதுதான் ப்ரோ.
ஆயிடுச்சு.
Yes, ma'am, you can start now.
A very good afternoon, one and all. Don't wait until everything is just right. It will never be perfect. There will always be challenges, obstacles, and less than perfect conditions. So what? Get started now. With each step you take, you will grow stronger and stronger, more and more skilled, more and more self-confident, and more successful. With this short note, on behalf of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam, I take immense pleasure in welcoming you all to this national webinar on current challenges in international law. And I am Brinda Devi, Assistant Professor, will be hosting today's event. A generous prayer is never presented in vain. The petition may be refused, but the petitioner is always rewarded by some gracious visitation. Prayer is the most important conversation of your today. Take it to God before you take it to anyone else. So, may I request the participants to rise for Tamil Thai Vaazhthu.
நீராறும் கடலுடுத்த நிலமடந்தை கெழிலொழுகும் சீராறும் மதனமென திகழ்வரதர் கண்டமிதில் எக்கணமும் அதில் சிறந்த திராவிடனல் திருநாடும் தக்க சிறு திரை முதலும் தரித்தனரும் திலகமுமே அத்திலக வாசனை போல் அனைத்துலகும் இன்பமுற எத்திசையும் புகழ் மணக்க இருந்த பெரும் தமிழடங்கே தமிழடங்கே உன் சீரிழமை திரும்பியந்து செயல் மறந்து வாழ்த்துதுமே வாழ்த்துதுமே வாழ்த்துதுமே
Thank you. Leadership is the capacity to translate vision into reality. Nowadays, the key to successful leadership is not being mere authoritative, but to be more of influencing. Here, we have a leader who influences everyone of us with a motherly pat on our shoulder to do things differently and guides us to explore along with her and to fly successfully with her. May I request our respected Madam Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh, Principal Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam, to deliver welcome address. Ma'am, over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Brinda. Respected dignitaries, panelists, principals, academicians, faculties, students, and members of the legal fraternity from various parts of the nation, I extend my warm welcome to one and all present here at this national webinar on current challenges in international law, organized by Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam, in association with the Directorate of Legal Studies. First and foremost, I take this opportunity to thank our respected Professor Dr. C. Chokkalingam, sir, the Director of Legal Studies, for encouraging, supporting, and guiding us throughout the planning of every event we have so far conducted in our college. Sir, we are greatly indebted to you for your unwavering support, and we guarantee you, sir, that our college will reach much more greater heights under your dynamic mentorship. Thank you, sir, for taking your time out to attend this webinar amidst your busy schedule. Welcome, sir. It gives me immense pleasure and joy to welcome the chief guest for today, my beloved sister, Dr. A. Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam, Principal, Government Law College, Chengalpattu, and Senate member of Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University. Many would know her, but then certain things you wouldn't have noticed in her, the things that she's a woman of grit, valor, and dynamism, which are the prime reasons for her successful management of Chengalpattu Law College. Moreover, she's a person of sincerity, hard work, and perseverance, which makes her a much sought-after academician in the field of law. I'm more happy to say that both of us are alumni of Madras Law College and Department of Legal Studies, Madras University, and we are batchmates in recruitment. Dear madam, I welcome you once again and thank you for accepting to grace the occasion. Welcome, madam. I'm happy to welcome the first panelist, rather more elated, I can say, to welcome the first panelist of the day, my guru, mentor, and guide, Professor Dr. A. Raghunatha Reddy, sir, HOD, Bharat Institute of Law at Bharat University. Sir is a very kind-hearted person, none can deny, with such rich experience and vast knowledge. And at this juncture, I am proud to say that I am his first PhD product at the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. Sir, you have been always a guiding light to me and to every other person out here in this audience. You know, all the principals, definitely they will accept and second my opinion here. So you have been always a guiding light to all of us, and I owe my every achievement to you, sir. As the saying goes, to the world, you may be just a teacher, but to your students, you are a star. Sir, you are always a superstar for me. I welcome you once again, sir. I extend my warm welcome to the second panelist, Professor Dr. T.R. Maruthi, Professor, Department of Studies in Law, University of Mysore. Sir has carved a niche for himself in the field of international law, and I'm sure the participants for today will be having an enriched session owing to his extensive knowledge in the field. Sir, I welcome you and I thank you for readily accepting our invite amidst your busy schedule, and I once again welcome you, sir.
Thank you, madam.
With these few words, I hand over the rest of the session to my young and energetic organizing team, headed by Senior Professor Mrs. C. Usha, assisted by the young and energetic assistant professors, Ms. V. Madhumita, Mrs. B. M. Brinda Devi, Dr. Shyam Sundar, Mrs. Hepzibah Bula, and Mrs. D. Kritika, who have worked meticulously for the successful conduct of today's webinar, and all my other dear faculty members who have made sincere efforts to enhance the quality of the day-to-day webinar so far. So I once again welcome all of you. Thank you.
A good start contributes to half success. Thank you, ma'am, for your wonderful, warm welcome address. Whatsoever the position we hold, our strength multiplies when we have like-minded people with us. Especially when those people encourage us, it induces more confidence in us to do things in a more perfect way. The person who is being supportive of every successful conversion of our vision into reality is none other than our Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. Singh Chokhalingam, sir. As emergent meeting awaits sir's presence, with his permission, we are skipping the protocol. Now, may I request our revered Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokhalingam, sir, to deliver special address. Sir, over to you.
Thank you. Very good afternoon to one and all. Respected Madam Gauri Ramesh, Principal of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Puthubakkam. Madam Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam, Able Administrator and Principal of Chengalpattu Government Law College. Professor Dr. Raghunatha Reddy, though he is my senior. He is one of our well-wisher and good friend. Professor Maruthi of Mysore University. My dear sister Tangaramani of Ramanathapuram Government Law College. And principals of other colleges, faculty members, and my dear students. Once again, I extend a very warm good afternoon to all of you. Really, it's very delighting to see that our reputed Government Law College is organizing a webinar on the topic which is very relevant today, because as students of law, we know very well. Recently, Israel and Hamas, they fought over, and the countries all over the world, they tried to put an end to this armed conflict between two factions. And I think even the United States of America tried its best to put an end to this conflict. But fortunately, the conflict came to an end. But as our discussion, as in our discussion, we will consider in detail. The world community is facing a great challenge, especially in the past 15 months, the world community, because of this worst pandemic, is facing a crisis. Pandemic may not know the borders. It swept almost all the countries, whether the countries are rich or poor. But students of international law may well aware how far international law will help the nations in facing the situations like this pandemic and other grave danger to the security of the nations. Jurists of international law may raise a doubt. Term international law itself is a misnomer, as we know. But as the reputed jurist, J.G. Stark, pointed out, even though there are many drawbacks in international law, though it is a weak law, really it is a law. In reality also, especially during the 20th century, many countries, right from America, on many occasions, they have violated the rules of international law. But to my knowledge, not even in one occasion, even a country like America didn't dispute the existence of international law. Their only argument is always, we have acted only in accordance with the principles of international law. Even very recently, scores of this back in the United Kingdom, the G7 countries, they have discussed to overcome this grave pandemic, and also they have considered the danger posed by countries like China due to its activities in South China Sea. So there may not be more appropriate than today to discuss the grave challenges before the nations, how far the nations are going to overcome not only this pandemic, but also the challenges. So I feel the topic chosen by our reputed Baker Government Law College is a very valid one. And I hope the participants will be much benefited by the matters being highlighted by our dear Principal Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam, dear Professor Raghunatha Reddy, and professor from our Mysore University. I hope everyone joined in the day's webinar will enjoy the session. Not only enjoy, they may enrich their knowledge by actively taking part in the day's webinar. I wish all the participants a great success. Once again, I thank Madam Gauri Ramesh and the organizers for giving me this opportunity. I wish the program a great success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So, thank you for joining us and showering your blessings amidst your very busy schedule. On behalf of our principal and Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupaka, I submit my deepest gratitude to you, sir. In the words of Florence Littar, giving encouragement to others is a most welcome gift, for the results of it are lifted spirits, increased self-worth, and a hopeful future. Today, we have a special guest with us who have been with us in all the endeavors that connect Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupaka, supporting and encouraging us in every possible way. She is none other than Professor Dr. A. Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam, Principal, Government Law College, Chengalpattu. Professor Dr. A. Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam, shortly known as AVR, amidst the academic circle, had been a science student in her school. Ma'am completed her BSc in physics and then joined 3 years law graduation in our prestigious Madras Law College. Yes, ma'am is our proud alumni. Her Master of Laws was in International Law and Constitutional Law from the Department of Legal Studies, University of Madras. Ma'am was awarded PhD by Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. After graduation, ma'am had been practicing for around 11 years. Later, she changed her course by joining as a lecturer, senior scale at Government Law College, Madurai. Later, from 2001, she was designated as assistant professor at Madras Law College, her alma mater. Currently, ma'am is serving as principal, Government Law College, Chengalpattu. Overall, she has 23 years of academic experience. We could say that only a very few faculties will be having both practicing and academic experience during her time of joining, and she is one among them. Ma'am's areas of interest are constitutional law, public international law, human rights law, humanitarian law, laws relating to women and children, and it goes on. In fact, ma'am has authored a book named Law Relating to Women and Children in Tamil, which is the most sought book by the students of Tamil Nadu for the subject. She is the editor of both the journal and the newsletter being published by Department of Legal Studies. Other than book, she has also authored more research articles in various reputed journals. Ma'am has also participated in various national and international seminars and workshops as a resource person and has also presented research papers. Besides participating, she has also conducted numerous seminars and workshops. Amidst her busy academic schedule, she holds a considerable number of posts in the administrative body, including member of Academic Senate, member of LLM Admission Board. Her other contributions include her being the chairperson of the Moot Court Committee at Madras Law College for more than a decade, vice chairman of the State Moot Court Committee for framing books for conducting national and state level intercollegiate book competitions. Ma'am, on behalf of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupaka, I take immense pleasure to welcome you to deliver felicitation address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Brinda.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon to all. Respected and beloved Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokalingam, from whom I learned the art of administration and managing crisis calmly. I greet Professor Dr. Raghunatha Reddy, sir, HOD, Bharat Institute of Law, Bharat University, who was the research director in TNDALU and who helped many research scholars to achieve their dream of obtaining PhD in law, including me. Thank you, sir. I greet Professor Dr. T.R. Maruti, Professor, Department of Studies in Law, University of Mysore. I'm eagerly waiting to hear you, sir, as the topic is close to my heart. I wholeheartedly thank my friend, Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh, Principal, Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupaka, for inviting me to be part of this webinar. Dr. Gauri Ramesh is a pioneer and she is a trendsetter in conducting webinars. She has so many firsts to her credit. She was the first to conduct online webinars among government law colleges in Tamil Nadu. Recently, she conducted a webinar in Tamil. And to do so, it was the first such venture exercised by a government law college in Tamil Nadu. I once again thank my friend, Dr. Gauri Ramesh, and I thank the organizers for this opportunity. Coming to the topic, current challenges in international law. Like you, I'm also eagerly waiting to hear from eminent professors their views on new challenges in international law and in specific topics. Apart from the two topics to be discussed by the professors, there are a few more current challenges in international law. Some of them are climate change, which poses an existential challenge to international law, the limits of international law's ability to force change on governments who are unwilling to accept it. Against this dark backdrop, the 2015 Paris Agreement achievements look modest. International cooperation is our only hope of tackling it, but it is difficult not to question whether the existing international architecture is up to the challenge. Be it the ICJ's advisory opinion on the Chagos Islands case that was between Mauritius and United Kingdom. The US Supreme Court's decision in Jam et al. Versus International Finance Corporation. You are aware, International Finance Corporation's claim was for absolute immunity and the Supreme Court rejected IFC's claim for absolute immunity is a win for human rights and business litigation. The crisis in the International Criminal Court, or you can deal with the issues related to WTO appellate body. These are all few current issues in international law. Not to forget the Myanmar issue in connection with Rohingya genocide case. The recent challenges related to cyberspace, cyber crimes, and outer space, and the challenges are endless. This is an apt area for diving deep, and I hope that the distinguished professors would bring in insights into the subject. This is very relevant to our times now. Thank you once again for this great opportunity. Thank you, Dr. Gauri Ramesh.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, ma'am, for your short and sweet felicitation address. Now, with all the blessings and wishes received from the guests, we will begin the session of today's national webinar on current challenges in international law. We have two eminent speakers for today's event, Professor Dr. A. Raghunath Reddy, Head of the Department, Bharat Institute of Law, Bharat University, and Professor Dr. T.R. Maruti, Professor, Department of Studies in Law, University of Nairobi. Without much delay, I would invite Ms. B. Madhumita, Assistant Professor, to introduce our first speaker, Professor Dr. A. Raghunath Reddy, and to moderate the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Brinda, ma'am. A very good afternoon, everyone present here. On behalf of everyone, I welcome our guest, Professor Dr. Raghunath Reddy, HOD, Bharat Institute of Law, Bharat University. I'm very much privileged and happy to welcome you, sir, to talk about Reddy, sir. As our principal rightly said, he's a man of kindness, grace, and he is a godfather to many of us. And indeed, he is also my professor. He, as a teacher, he has 30 years of experience in UG and PG level. He served 12 years in SK University and 15 years in Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Chennai. He's also acting as a visiting professor, resource person, and also delivered lectures at various reputed institutions such as Gosanga Law School, Spokane, Seattle, USA, Osmania University, Hyderabad, University of Mysore, University of Madras, Annamalai University for ML, Indian Maritime University, Uthandi, and VIT, Vellore, SRM, Savita, and Bharat Law Schools, and various other law schools. He also participated in various conferences, seminars, and workshops, panel discussions, symposia as a research person, and presented around 70 papers, research papers. He organized 15 seminars, conferences at national, state, and regional level in Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University in collaboration with various organizations. He's also a member of Indian Law Institute, New Delhi, Commonwealth Legal Education Association, London, Asian Society of International Law, UGC NAC for accreditation of NAC to universities and colleges, PG Board of Studies, and in Tiendalu, Research Body of Studies in Tiendalu, Board of Studies in Pondicherry University, Board of Studies Maritime University, Board of Studies at National University of Advanced Legal Studies. He's a member of several other committees, like for inspection, for affiliating various institutions. And he's also editor-in-chief of Ambedkar Law University Journal and National Students Law Journal at Tiendalu. He is an academic senate member and syndicate member at Tiendalu. As a researcher, he completed minor as well as major researches, such as Project UGC on Press in 1995, Monopoly and New Economic Policy in 1998, and legal reforms in 2004. So he's also acting as an examiner, adjudicator of PhD and LLD theses of different universities. He's a member of doctoral committee of Bharat School of Law and Wales Law School, Chennai. He is also invited to judge various moot court competitions at the national and international level. He published more than 35 papers in leading legal journals, and he is a course writer for the law of the contracts and legal regulations of economic enterprises for LLM course in Annamalai University. He visited several countries on academic assignments, the countries such as South Australia, Colombo, Sri Lanka, University of Windsor, Ontario, Canada. He presented a paper in an international conference organized by Asian Law Institute at International Islamic University, Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. He also visited Beijing, USA and Singapore during 2011 to 2015 on academic assignments. As an administrator, he has experience as a head of the department, dean, and he is a director research and publication, and a HOD of the Department of International Law till date in Tamil Nadu Dr. University, Ambedkar Law University, syndicate member and academic senate member. He has performed as an in charge and acting vice chancellor in Tiendalu on different occasions. He is member and convener of various committees in Tiendalu. So thank you for your presence, sir. So thank you, sir, for your presence among us. I invite you to deliver your wonderful lecture, sir. The forum is
to you. Thank you, Madhumita. So, is it audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Professor Dr. Chokkalingam, the DLS. Professor Dr. Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam, Principal, Government Law College, Changalpet, the chief guest of today's webinar. Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh, the Principal of the Government Law College. Then the other principals, my dear colleagues, it gives me a great pleasure to be in your midst for delivering a lecture on the current challenges in international law. Very recently, the principal of the Government Law College, Changalpet, organized a webinar on contemporary challenges in constitutional law. I was one of the speakers. Today, Professor Gauri Ramesh is organizing a seminar on current challenges in international law. So you are organizing webinars at a time when this challenge is posed by corona virus 19 pandemic. Fortunately, we have converted all these challenges into wonderful opportunities for organizing this type of seminars. So friends, if you look at international today, it is not the same it was as it was before. When we were students of international law some 40 years ago, it was entirely different. The traditional international law was a product of Christian civilization, European civilization, Eurocentricism, state-oriented concept of international law. There were doubts when we were studying international law, doubts as to the legal character, legal validity of international law, whether international law is truly a law or not. Is international law a positive morality, as Austin has said? Whether international law is a vanishing point of jurisprudence? First of all, you say whether international law is a law or at all. If it is a law, is it a weak law? Whether there are any sanctions behind international law? These are the questions raised. Even now, so therefore, the traditional international law was in a kind of crisis. But if you look at the modern international law, which has expanded very fast, in the light of the changing character and expanding contours of international law, though the foundations of international law, as it is understood today, lie firmly rooted in Western culture and political organization, it has transformed entirely different. So the modern international law has flowered and still flowering with the sophistication of Renaissance of Europe and sophistication of positivist approaches towards international law. If you want to know the jurisprudential aspects of international law, one of the most influential of Greek concepts taken up by the Romans was the idea of natural law. This was formulated by Stoic philosophers, and their theory was that it constituted a body of rules of universal relevance. This element of universality is basic to the modern doctrines of international law. And certain Roman philosophers incorporated these Greek ideas of natural law into their own legal theories as ultimate justification for jus gentium. So natural law in the Roman ancient Greek period, jus gentium in the Roman period, Saint Thomas Aquinas maintained that natural law formed part of law of God, divine law. Divinity is attached to natural law. Sir Henry Maine, who is the father of comparative law, wrote that the birth of modern international law was the grandest function of the law of nature. It was Hugo Grotius, who is the father of modern international law, a supreme Renaissance man, finally excised theology, removed, divorced natural law from theology, from divinity, and rationalized international law. So the positivist approach, the sophisticated positivist approach, which was derived from empirical method, was adopted by Renaissance and reformulation. Empiricism was formulated by John Locke and Hume. John Locke, who is the classical natural law philosopher. So therefore, after Hugo Grotius, there was a clash between the philosophers as naturalists and positivists. Samuel Pufendorf attempted to identify international law completely with the law of nature. Positivists like Binkershock distinguished between international law and natural law. So therefore, the foundation of modern international law on the principles of natural law cannot be denied. And the principles of natural law has given birth to so many human rights also. So therefore, the traditional international law, as defined by Professor L. Oppenheim, was a law, a body of treaty and customary and conventional rules governing relations between the civilized nations in their intercourse with each other. Only states were the subjects of international law, and only the states. What about the international organizations? What about the multinational corporations? What about the non-governmental organizations? What about the individuals? So individuals were mostly objectified by the traditionalist. So the objectification of the individual was made by these traditional international lawyers. But in view of the rapid changes in different fields of law, developments in science and technology, nuclear weapons, then space exploration, deep ocean exploration, so on and so, the international trade, international environment. So many activities are now, there is increasing internationalization of environmental law, international environmental law, international trade law, international human rights law, international humanitarian law, international refugee law. Everything is preceded by the word international. So therefore, the traditional international law is superseded by a law of social interdependence propelled by globalization. So you find the modern international law already manifested in the UN Charter. The UN Charter is the constitution for United Nations Organization. So before United Nations Organization, we had a League of Nations after the First World War. The League of Nations was the child of war. After the World War II, conclusion of World War II, the United Nations Organization is set up on the basis of UN Charter. Therefore, UN Charter is a world treaty having universal character. This is the constitution for United Nations Organization. People say that UN Charter is more than a treaty and less than the constitution. So therefore, the future of international law is the future of international organizations. The international organizations have become a common and regular feature of international life. After the conclusion of the Second World War, modern international law has evolved around the individual. Once the individual was objectified, now the individual is brought to the center stage. I can say, if you look at the jurisprudential aspect of the individual, you will find emancipation of individual from feudal lords after Renaissance and Reformation, and the secularization of international law. Why? Because in the beginning, it was law of nature was theological, philosophical. In the medieval age, law of nature was metaphysical. Modern is it is more positivist. So therefore, even Professor L. Oppenheim has thoroughly refined his definition of international law in his 9th edition. Now it is well established that international law comprises not only customary and conventional rules, but also general principles of law recognized by civilized nations. So therefore, international law is not merely a product of Christian civilization or a body of treaty and customary rules. What about the general principles of law recognized by civilized nations, as it is there in the statute of ICJ under Article 38. So therefore, now international law comprises the general principles of law recognized by civilized nations. It is the inexhaustible reservoir for the international organizations, for the international court to enrich itself. So indeed, it is the so many international general principles of law recognized by civilized nations, like estoppel, like res judicata, ad altum, partem. All these are principles at the domestic level. Now you will find internationalization of this law. All these principles got globalized, internationalized. So therefore, the present international law is, to some extent, is based upon the Charter of United Nations Organization, and it is developing despite the weakness of the organization institution. The charter gives a place of prominence, significance to the individuals, and that is why human rights are developing under the present international law like anything. So therefore, you'll find it is the development of modern international has begun after the establishment of UN Charter. We can say after the establishment of UN Charter only the international law started developing. So therefore, international law in its turn derives inspiration from Charter. So you will find in the Charter international human rights. After the establishment of United Nations Organization, we had UDHR in the year 1948, two other UN covenants on civil and political rights, social, cultural, and educational rights, CEDA. So many treaties and conventions guaranteeing international human rights. CEDA is a Magna Carta for women. So all these treaties protecting, safeguarding the fundamental freedoms and international human rights is the law developed by United Nations Organization. So this subject, international organization is subjects, one of the subjects of international is thoroughly, missed in the traditional international. So many now after the establishment of United Nations Organization, so many things are happening. So many treaties, Vienna, so many UN Convention on the Law of Sea, four UN Conventions on the Law of Sea. What about the Stockholm Conference, the Earth Summit in 1992, UN the Environmental Program. So therefore, so many things are happening. Much law is created by the United Nations Organization, and the resolutions of the Security Council is also a law. The resolutions of the United Nations General Assembly is law. What about the law created by International Law Commission for the Progressive Development of International Law? What is the contribution of ILS? It has prepared so many draft treaties, draft rules on state responsibility. So therefore, you cannot undermine the significance, the importance of international organization in the creation, in the generation of international law. So this is one of the positive and progressive developments of significant contribution of the United Nations Organization in social, economic, and cultural fields. So therefore, UN has become an indispensable organization. And after the setting up of United Nations Organization, we have no war. There is no war. We had two world wars, but there is no third war. Credit squarely goes to the United Nations Organization. So therefore, in the evolution of international affairs since the World War II, one of the most decisive events that has taken place is disintegration of colonial empires and the birth of scores of new states. After decolonization, there was proliferation of so many new states, so-called developing states, third world countries. The emergence of new states has made the international society almost universal. Why? Because these are the third world countries, and their interest, their civilization, their culture, these all these third world countries, G77 countries, now it is more than 77. All these countries are now equally represented. You will find African, Asian countries fully represented in UN General Assembly, International Law Commission, and also UN Security Council. So therefore, there is an increasing internationalization of international law. This is an increasing internationalization of international law. Hitherto, international law was mainly based upon the concepts of coexistence and reciprocity. From the international law of coexistence and reciprocity, international law has transformed into the international law of cooperation and law of social interdependence. So therefore, these states have become the so-called developing states have a common history of foreign dominance, underdevelopment, because they are in the various stages of development, socially, culturally, with the different backgrounds, national identities. Hence, they are not homogeneous group. So widely differing social, cultural, economic attitudes, stages of development characterize them as third world countries. So these new states now have largely embraced the ideas of sovereignty, equality of states, non-aggression, non-intervention in the search for their security. This new internationalization of international law has destroyed the European-based sovereignty and European-based hegemony, homogeneity. The composition, as I said, you know. So therefore, my dear friends, this is very important. Now, the modern international law has already manifested itself in the Charter of United Nations Organization and the UN wish to promote peace. India is a peace-loving nation, which is a member of United Nations Organization. More than 193 nations are the members of United Nations Organization. And the UN Charter is binding not only on the members, but also on the non-members. So therefore, there is one provision under the TT law, TT, neck no cent, neck pro cent, that does not apply to the UN Charter because it is binding on the strangers, it is binding on the non-members of the United Nations Organization. So therefore, the interdependence of the nations is one of the cornerstone of new law of nations and the birth of the law of international human rights is nothing but the cornerstone of the new law of nations, the Charter of United Nations Organization. So therefore, the traditional international law was envisaged as a law governing the relations between sovereign nations, which is not correct. The most important change that has taken place is that of addition of new subjects like international organizations, multinational corporations, individuals. Now the individual is brought to the center stage and human rights at its heart. Multinational corporations, international NGOs, non-governmental organization. So it is worth noting to say that the role played by the Amnesty International and the Human Rights Watch, the human rights NGOs, what is the role they played in the formulation of UN Charter and for the setting up of United Nations Organization in San Francisco? What is the role of international environmental NGOs, like Greenpeace, Blue Cross? What is the role of these NGOs in the formulation of international environmental law. So see the contribution of international non-governmental organizations in the generation and creation of international law. This is worth mentioning now. So therefore, most important change that is imperative. Now there is a decisive shift that has taken place from formal regulation of diplomatic relations from states to an international law of welfare of the citizen, welfare of the people, welfare of the individual is now very important for us. Now, after the establishment of United Nations Organization, the development of the concept of human rights tended to make international law as a branch of universal application. Now, international law has become a branch of, it has become a multi-dimensional subject, a branch of jurisprudence of universal application. Human rights could no longer be characterized as a domestic issue and hidden by the veil of state sovereignty. Globalization has been transformative in terms of reconceptualizing the state sovereignty within international. So therefore, globalization has created powerful non-state actors. State, which is one of the subjects of international law. Now there are more non-state actors that may violate human rights in so many ways. So therefore, which was not contemplated during the development of modern human rights movement. So therefore, my dear friends, the concepts of natural law. So in the beginning, if you look at the municipal law, it is essentially working in a centralized system, but international law is working in a decentralized system. There are new trends regarding the basis of obligation in international. What is that? One of the most important changes that have taken place is many decisions at international conferences, General Assembly, and the UN Security are adopted by consensus. The fort of unanimity rule seems to be crumbling against the onslaught of majority rule in international organization. This is a change necessitated, a change in the theory of obligation. So therefore, the basis of obligation in international law is changing from state-oriented sovereignty, concept consent of sovereignty, to community-oriented consensus. And another important pointing, the role of natural law developed from time to time have gradually influenced the growth of international law. For that matter, the Nuremberg principles. which has fixed direct criminal responsibility on the individual. So this is nothing but natural law principle now found in the UN Charter. All these Nuremberg principles are found in the UN Charter. It is become an international law. So therefore, the international organization, for example, United Nations organization, is a legal person. Just like the other international organization, the United Nations organization is a legal person. It has got a legal personality. It was held so by the ICJ in the reparations case, reparations for the injuries suffered in the services of United Nations organization. So therefore, UN is capable of enforcing its rights to claiming compensation when its services were suffered in the United Nations organization. So therefore, the proliferation of new states, proliferation of so many international organizations has not only made Eurocentricism in thinking about international law as anachronistic, but it has brought qualitative changes in the norms and principles of international law. So this is a very important change. And another important change is the development. There is a development movement from bilateralism to multilateralism and protection of community interest. These interests have some commonalities that go far beyond the interests held by the states. They correspond to the needs, hopes, fears of all human beings. Therefore, the solution for this problem may be decisive for the survival of the entire international community. So therefore, although the international law is in crisis, an irreversible process of internationalization is gaining momentum. This is internationalization of international law, one aspect. Another aspect is law is internationalized. And there is another aspect. International law is also nationalized. See, you see the fast development. See the changing character of international law. Now, international law is domesticated. International law is nationalized. International law is glocalized. Think globally and act locally. So therefore, you see the Lotus case, ex parte Pinochet. International law is domesticated in different ways, in different legal systems. Now you will find hybridization in the process of nationalizing international law. Now international law is nationalized. You must be knowing under constitutional law, so many international instruments were applied by the Supreme Court of India into the constitutional field, starting from Keshavananda Bharati, Vishakha, and so on. So therefore, in so many other cases, how the international instruments were read into the domestic system, into the constitutional field by the Supreme Court. So this is nothing but glocalization or domestication of international law. So once international law was seen as historic preserve that did not feature significantly in national courts, now times have changed. Now domestic violence is no longer viewed as a matter essentially within the domestic jurisdiction of a state. So therefore, international law is first, it was a mistook. International law was being a law between the states was staked first on the territorial hegemony of the principle of territoriality, thus weakening the concept of a person. The personhood, the person, the individualization was thoroughly ignored. It was viewed that there was no international law without state, without territory, without sovereignty. This is one of the essential dogmas of international law. Now the trend of international law is changing towards fixing direct responsibility on the individuals. See the Genocide Convention. There is now direct responsibility on the, we know the state responsibility. State is responsible for the injuries caused to the other states, for environmental pollution, for atmospheric pollution. Because a state has to treat its territory without injuring the territory of other states. State is under erga omnes obligations. Okay, but what is this direct fixing direct individual responsibility on the end? This is, to my mind, a wonderful development in international law. So therefore, I can say international law binds individuals. You should never forget. Now international law binds individuals. Just like municipal law, which is binding on all individuals, international law is also binding the individuals. We are bound by the international principles. So therefore, this development has, UN Charter has so many other developments. Now we are entitled for so many rights, so many duties on the individuals. What are the duties? There is a duty. All these jurisprudence, we are bound by jurisprudence norms, erga omnes obligations. So there is, you cannot commit piracy. Piracy is an international crime. Hijacking, slave trading, they are all international crimes. War crimes, crimes against humanity, crimes against peace, genocide. So all these crimes, international crimes, fix direct criminal responsibility on the individual. This is the wonderful development in international law, which was not there earlier. So therefore, now there is a movement, paradigm shift from state centricism to individual responsibility. State centric to individual centric, person centric. personhood of an individual is recognized. So therefore, now there is a movement from conferring rights on the individuals, even against the states of which individuals are nationals. So therefore, now there is no more objectification of the individual. So you see, personalizing the law is indispensable to the development of modern legal studies. This is very important. Personalizing the individuals is indispensable to the development of modern legal studies, international humanitarian law, private international law. So therefore, state is too small for global issues, yet too large for local ones. The most important decisions of our day, global security, elimination of poverty, reduction, non-proliferation of nuclear arms, should be dealt with by structures that transcend the concepts of borders of a state. So therefore, there are so many concepts which are transcending. You see the Jaskogin's norms, which is found under the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties under Article 53 and 64. Jaskogin's norms, so they are the principles. There are certain principles under international law. And these principles, all the states must observe. They cannot be altered by concluding a treaty. If any treaty is concluded, it is void in the light of emergence of, peremptory norms of general international law. So peremptory norms of international law were accepted, approved by all the members of the international community as a whole. So they possess, because they possess the character of Jaskogin's. So they are all customary principles and treaty norms, non-derogable rights attaining the status of Jaskogin's. Now, these principles of Jaskogin's, all the states must observe. There is no excuse. They cannot be altered by entering a treaty. Why? Because they possess the character of Jaskogin's. They are customary rules of international law having peremptory norms, non-derogable. They have gained importance in fields. Otherwise, in the beginning, it was applicable only to the treaty regime. Now it has transcended the treaty regime, entered into the state responsibility, environmental law, human rights law, refugee law, international humanitarian law and criminal law, etc., etc. So therefore, you find the transformation of the position of the individual. Now the modern international, I want to say that international law, now this international humanitarian law is to humanize, international humanitarian law, human rights law is to humanize an individual. It is to humanize the international principles. So therefore, there is a great transformation of the position of the individual after the conclusion of the Second World War. It is one of the remarkable developments of international law in the contemporary period. So now, international law being a law between the states was staked, and the totality, now it has crumbled. Now there is no international. See, once it was the view that there is no international without state, territory and sovereignty. So this is one of the essential dogmas. So the globalization has created, as I said, powerful state actors. And now you see the immunities, jurisdiction, which is one of the sovereign attributes of a state. If you talk about jurisdiction, there is immunity from jurisdiction also. So there is one principle which I would like to discuss in this August gathering. So the state, the personified doctrine of sovereignty has been metamorphosed into state sovereign doctrine of state sovereignty. So now in the state sovereignty doctrine, the doctrine of foreign sovereignty is one of the customary principles of international. Once it was personified concept of sovereign, king can do no wrong, feudal principle, king is not at all responsible, you cannot institute civil and personal criminal proceedings. This personified concept of international law, sovereign immunity, metamorphosed into state sovereignty with the emergence of republican forms of government in US and Europe. So now the law of sovereign immunity has been undergoing so many changes since the last two decades in the state practice. So in the, if you look at the celebrated cases, you know, now the state sovereign is not at all immune from violation of human rights. Now, a state sovereign, the sovereigns of a particular state, the king or the crown, they are bound by the jus cogens norms, jus cogens norms. But unfortunately, if you look at the tension between the universalism and particularism, universalism and cultural relativism, the third world countries take the excuse of particularism, and openly they will fragrantly they will violate jus cogens norms. So therefore, the my dear friends, now immunities are conferred on the state high ranking officials. Traditional international law confers absolute immunity to the sovereign and high ranking officials without any exception. But with the increase in commercial activities by the states and state officials, coupled with the advent of human rights discourse, now these immunities in modern international are restrictively interpreted. States are held accountable for human rights violations and also for violating jus cogens norms. So ICC further reiterates this aspect under Article 27 of Rome Statute, wherein immunity cannot be a ground for commission of heinous crimes like crimes against humanity, genocide, war crimes, crimes of aggression, etc. So therefore, the UN Charter is very significant. Why? Because though there is an expansion of international law, diversification of international law horizontally and virtually, where once it was only the states, now so many new states after the World War I, after the conclusion of Second World War, so many, there was a proliferation of new states, third world countries. Now this is horizontal expansion. Vertical expansion is that not only the states, international organizations, the multinational corporations, the individuals, and also the non-governmental organizations have a role to play. They have a say in international relations. This is vertical expansion. So though there is expansion and diversification of international law, there is fragmentation of international law. Globalization is the culprit for fragmentation. It is the globalization, the phenomena of globalization, which has tarred international law into pieces. So as a result, now international law is now confined to so many regional groups. There is a regionalization, grouping, subgrouping, regrouping like that. So now you'll find the modern international has expanded to areas like investment law, trade law, environmental law, energy law. So see the economic law. We have two organizations, IMF and World Bank, after the two Bretton Woods conference. So now you will find the expansion of international law, refined interpretation of international law, and the interpretative tools of international law. There is proliferation of specialized dispute settlement bodies like WTO, ICSID, like that. So there is so many subgroups, specialized agencies. As a result, there is a problem for jurisdictional problems like that. So therefore, happening nowadays. Now, if you see another important jus cogens. So jus cogens, I can say, finds its roots in international law, in natural law. the purpose of JESCO agency is to protect the interest of the international community of the state, to protect everyone. So therefore, the object of erga omnes obligations and JESCO agency norms are similar, but they are two different things. Though at times there is overlapping between erga omnes obligations and JESCO agency norms, but still they are two different things. But it is to preserve the ethical values. Under modern international law, ICJ and ILC are regarded as fulcrums of codification and progressive development of international law. So therefore, the emergence of JESCO agency norms has infused ethical content in international law. With the advent of numerous stakeholders, there are so many stakeholders of not only the states, the other subjects, you know, the scope of JESCO agency has transcended the treaty framework and it has forayed into the other areas. It is for the protection of humankind, mankind, and the interest of the international community. So therefore, it is JESCO agency is the fulcrum in humanization of international law. The role of JESCO agency now transcends the state-centric undertaking to individual-centric as a subject of right. It is a value enhancer in international law, a guardian of individual values. JESCO agency reflects the constitutional norm of international law. You know, there are, if you see the constitutional law, Indian constitution, there is one doctrine called as constitutionalism as expounded by the natural law philosophers John Locke and others. So this JESCO agency, which is in international field, is similar to the constitutionalism, constitutional morality like that. Constitutionalism, now it has grown into the international constitutionalism, transnational constitutionalism. So therefore, in the UN Charter, constitutionalism, transnational constitutionalism, just like JESCO agency, erga omnes obligations are abundantly available in UN Charter, ICC, the Rome Statute, and Nuremberg Tribunals, etc., etc. So therefore, now the international human rights are treated as JESCO agency. Right to life is JESCO agency. Prohibition of torture, JESCO agency. Prohibition of enforced disappearance is JESCO agency. Prohibition of slavery is JESCO agency. Non-aggression, JESCO agency. Prohibition of apartheid, racial discrimination, JESCO agency. Genocide, prohibition of genocide, anti-piracy, anti-slavery, sustainable development is JESCO agency. You see, Gapsikovo arbitration. So now common heritage of mankind is also JESCO. See the wonder, common heritage of mankind is JESCO agency. So therefore, what is common heritage of mankind? There are common heritage of mankind represents an extension of the earlier concept of province of mankind. Province of mankind was found in 1959 Antarctic Treaty, reaffirmed in Outer Space Treaty 1967. So it was Arvid Pardo, the Malta ambassador to the United Nations Organization, to globalize the right to entry and use of global commons. Hence, all the unclaimed wealth of the earth must be regarded as the common heritage of mankind. Just like Antarctica, the ocean play, the ocean floor, the moon and other celestial bodies, which are regarded as a common heritage of mankind. So therefore, now you'll find there is an ethical framework on environmental program of action. What is the ethical framework means? Don't touch common heritage of mankind, intergenerational equity, common equity. So therefore, there is always a tug of war between the developed nations and developing nations, achieving developments without a destruction. Why? Because now the concept of sustainable development is brought in. So what is sustainable development? As I said, sustainable development is also a JESCO agency norm. Just as development cannot be sustained without environmental progress, prosperity of the rich cannot be sustainable without the progress of the poor. I will put it in some other way. Achieving developments without destruction, progress without poverty, will require international cooperation. So therefore, the geriatric societies of the rich and the pediatric societies of the poor will have to work too fast for bridging the gap between north and south. Now, regional organizations, north-south dialogue, south-south dialogue, east and west. Now, G7 nations recently, they met. You will find the more regionalism, fragmentation of international law, my dear friends. So therefore, the what is this, the cause of this fragmentation means globalization has, it is the globalization which has, promoted, which has proliferated this fragmentation of international law. So there are so many things. There are so many things in fragmentation. Just I will mention a few of these fragmentations, points of the fragmentation. So what are they? So for example, the the system of international law, now if you look at the international principles, the one of the essential features of modern international law is fragmentation. The system of international law has become increasingly fragmented, particularly since the end of Cold War. What are the factors responsible for the increased fragmentation, the proliferation of international regulations, increasing political fragmentation like regionalism, sectionalism, regional groupings, regroupings, etc., emancipation of individual from the state, regionalization of international law. Presently, there exists no homogeneous system of international law, particularly for the third world countries. So therefore, fragmentation always promotes unorganized system, regional erratic blocks, elements of subsystem, full of intra-systematic tensions, contradictions, and frictions. So therefore, the disintegration of the legal order jeopardizes credibility, reliability, and consequently, the authority of the international law will be crumbling. So therefore, there is a growing sectionalism and regionalism around the globe that has led to the creation of regional legal regimes, specialized regimes. So as a result, there is a norm conflicting. There are around 125 dispute resolution mechanisms, courts. We know only PCIJ, ICJ, Permanent Court of Arbitration, but there are so many other dispute resolution bodies. So dispute settlement institutions have proliferated, different mechanisms of enforcement, problems of jurisdiction, problems of diversification. So therefore, fragmentation reflects the multi-layer system of international law. Now, the focus of international law has moved away from elaboration of general rules to the specialized regimes. So like this, everywhere there is a fragmentation, my dear friends. So therefore, my dear friends, it is globalization which has unleashed the internationalization of international law. This is a positive development, but at the same time, globalization has, precipitated a fragmentation. Globalization has transformed international sphere into another dimension. Okay, so these are all the developments. Globalization. Because of the globalization, now so many non-state actors, particularly the corporations, multinational corporations have developed. So this is one of the developments of globalization. when there is a violation of human rights not by the state, but by non-state actors, what do the law will do? Multinational enterprises operate in an international plane. So this is posing a great challenge to the modern international human rights movement. So therefore, international human rights are globalized and they operate beyond all borders and mechanisms. So now this globalization has produced a new type of transboundary criminal enterprise. International crimes, as I was saying, involve human rights violations are increasing. Illegal drugs trade, money laundering, arms trafficking, human trafficking, they are all facilitated by technological advancement and globalization. So therefore, there are both positive aspects and negative aspects of globalization. But then globalization has promoted increased internationalization of international law, internationalization being domesticated at the domestic level. So both the ways. So it has helped. Now you'll find expansion of modern international law, both horizontally and vertically. So this is how you can understand international law. So when I was student of international law, I never knew all these developments. These are the developments taking place very recently now. So therefore, now international law has become a multi-dimensional subject. The individual is the welfare of the individual. Humanism. You see the one of the judgments in Gapsikovo judgment, Nagamaris Gapsikovo arbitration. Humanism is very important. The welfare of the human being is important for the modern international law, which was greatly missing in the traditional international concept. So I thank very much. I thank Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh for giving me an opportunity to share my views. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful lecture. It was indeed a thought-provoking, and it was actually a feast to us. We really enjoyed it, sir. So due to paucity of time, we are moving to next session. Over to Brinda, ma'am. So audience, we have noted your questions. The question will be forwarded to the resource person, and the answers will be forwarded to you soon. Thank you. Over to Brinda, ma'am.
Thank you, sir, for your detailed and enlightening session. Thank you, Madhavita ma'am, for moderating the session. Next, may I invite Ms. S. Mano, Assistant Professor, to introduce our next speaker, Professor Dr. T.R. Maruti, and to moderate the session. Over to you, Mano ma'am.
Thank you, Brinda ma'am. A teacher plants the seeds of knowledge, sprinkles them with love, and they patiently nurtures their growth to produce tomorrow's dream. As described in this quote, an ideal example for a teacher is our speaker, Professor Dr. Maruti sir. It is my pleasure to tell a few words about him to this forum. Professor Dr. Maruti sir is teaching international law in the Department of Studies in Law, University of Mysore. He has been awarded his PhD on the thesis titled Legal Regime of the Seabed, a Critical Study from the University of Mysore. He has published more than 86 articles in national and international journals. He was invited as a resource person in 150 conferences and workshops. He has served as chairman of Department of Studies in Law and a director of Mysore University School of Law and the University of Mysore. His area of research are law of sea, air and space law, international economic law, private international law, international trade law, cybersecurity, human rights, international humanitarian law, refugee law, diplomacy, transnational and supranational issues, vulnerable sections of society, and UN operations. It is my immense pleasure to invite Professor Maruti sir to enlighten us through his lecture on the topic of the protection of internally displaced person in international law and appraisal. Now the floor is open for you, sir. Yes, sir,
we are able to see your screen.
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir. Our screen is visible, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Very good afternoon to each one of you. Is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. dear participants, esteemed colleagues. In fact, I am indeed privileged and honored to be a part of this webinar, which is being held on current challenges of public international law. No doubt that much has been discussed on international law. Nothing is left out to me. First of all, let me congratulate organizers for having gone through one of the interesting subjects of the today's juncture. Thanks to the organizers for having gone through interesting topic. Professor Chokkalingam, Director of Legal Studies, Tamil Nadu. Madam Professor Vijayalakshmi, Principal, Government Law College, Chennai. Convener of this webinar, Professor Gauri Ramesh, Principal, Government Law College, Chennai. Birunta Devi, Madam Birunta Devi, Professor of Law, Government Law College, Chennai. Esteemed Professor Raghunath Reddy sir, Bharat Institute of Law, Bharat University. So I know him personally. He has been actually known for his intensive studies on public international law. I was just going through his screen to share a few thoughts on philosophical foundations on public international law. No doubt that international law is a law. Roots are there in jurisprudence. This is one of the offshoots of jurisprudence, one has to understand. No doubt, why states obey international law? We need it. That's why we, states obey public international law as such. In the recent past, there has been much discussion going on at the international level about the new challenges, which are highly expressive, not only in the municipal level, but also in international level. You have to understand. I mean to say, the ongoing crises are actually squeezing the very philosophy of public international law. No doubt, the philosophy of public international law has come through on the basis of historical antecedents that you have to understand. We had 30 years of war, especially in Europe. Europe was a battlefield. There was no scope for protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms as well. We took almost 30 years of war, which was put an end on the basis of a Treaty of Westphalia, 1648. Then many scholars started writing on public international, none other than Gentilis, Hugo Grotius, Prufendorf, Banker Shock, Lauterpacht, Oppenheim, Brierley, Stark, as many as writers could start sharing few thoughts on the public international law as such. No doubt, there are so many ongoing crises in these days. Have a look on. It could be world hunger, poverty, global warming, mental health issues, terrorism, that too, religious terrorism is going on. Could be Boko Haram, ISIL, Taliban, and many. Look at Yemen civil war, Syrian civil war, Libyan civil war, Israeli-Palestine conflict. It's ongoing. It's never ending. Then North Korea and weapons of mass destruction is going on. Qatar diplomatic crisis, then a replication crisis, Iran-Saudi proxy conflict, Ukrainian crisis, crisis in Venezuela, then territorial disputes in a South China Sea, Rohingya genocide, 2007, it's going on now. Indo-Pakistan war and conflicts, Korean conflicts. Look at COVID-19 outbreak, 2020. Then cultural, genocide. All these are actually unprecedented in these days. Then what do you do on the basis of a public international law? Why is public international law is actually playing an important role to resolve some of the disputes between states themselves? Why it has come through? What are the reasons? Of course, there are some queries in understanding public international law in otherwise manner. Some say General Assembly resolutions and Security Council recommendations are supposed to be called as if soft measures, and others are hard legislation. What do you mean by soft law and hard law? How can you understand soft law and hard law? This is what your Asif Qureshi has already been outspoken in his book, International Economic Law. Your soft law has have come through on the basis of a mere expression of preference. I agree with you. Sometimes in absence of a hard legislations, soft law will play an important role. You have to understand in which you have already been gone through. Part third and part fourth of the Constitution of India. They should go hand in hand. This is what the harmonious construction theory has already been answered. You have to understand, thanks to Supreme Court of India in bringing harmonious construction between these two, parts, which are highly expressive, with you to understand socio-economic and cultural justice. I mean to say that the fruits of justice should be shared to the people who are left out in the society as a whole. I mean to say the economic, social, and cultural justice should be shared to the people who are left out in the society. Many people are highly marginalized, weaker, retracted, and you are sidelining them. Like any other manner, however it could be. And some people, they read international law, they are not understanding. Some people, they know how to understand international law, but they don't know how to interpret international law. Third, some people, they read it, they know how to understand it, they know how to interpret public international law. When they are sitting at the higher level, their ideas are highly safe-cornered, and they do have their own sweeping statements. This is really pathetic when it comes to the knowledge of public international law as such. No matter, much has been discussed from a different perspectives are concerned. That's why, it has been rightly pointed out by Professor, eminent professor, I coin it, Professor Raghunath Reddy, sir, in which he has gone through almost all the basic principles of public international law. It could be erga omnes, look at jus cogens, pacta sunt servanda. It means pact must be respected. Jus gentium, jus civilis, jus naturalis. How in what manner earlier history was so helpful in order to understand public international law in an appropriate manner. So why states obey international law? My answer is very, very simple. They need it. That's why. If you don't follow public international law, you'd be isolated and victimized at the international level. That's why states are very much interested to follow public international law with a view to overcome their own historical issues and challenges are concerned. In this context, understanding international law, even from the perspective of the efforts made by Hugo Grotius, very well, as you have already been gone through, in which you know, he has gone through step by step in order to understand peace and war. None other than De Jurabili Act Passis and Mare Liberum. Look at these two main legendary of thoughts have given you to shape public international in an appropriate manner. What he has emphasized on the basis of his own silver linings. What is peace? Peace, it does not mean it is an absence of war. Peace means presence of justice. We need to have international justice in these days. Otherwise, how can you overcome, as it has been emphasized in the last presentations? Before the coming into force of UN Charter and its half-century enactments, individuals had to be treated as charters. It was because of efforts made by the International Court of Justice in a case, reparation for injuries suffered in UN administration, which was actually decided accordingly. Since then, individuals are also accountable to public international law. Be sued and to be sued are also vis-a-vis applicable. So this is what one has to understand as and when you deal with public international law in an appropriate manner. Of course, no doubt, there are so many conflicts which are highly expressive when it comes to the knowledge of the public international assets, whether right to food is fundamental or right to life is fundamental. You should understand. Perhaps you may have gone through one of the interesting illustrations while you were actually studying at the LKG level as such. Look at, you know, wolf theory. Wolf is actually standing before sheep and demanding, I have a right to, food. I want to kill you. Then sheep replied politely, wolf, however, you might have got a right to food, but I have a right to life. You cannot kill me. So these are the, you know, conflicting interests are there, not only in municipal law, but also in international law. But you should know how to resolve them. There is a room for discussing all these issues. There is a platform to decide. You are a better judge what is right and what is wrong. What is right for me may not be right for you. But there is a lot of scope to understand rightness. This is what, you know, a natural law philosophy has already been taught us to understand rightness. This has to be looked into with a view to understand these peripheral issues which are highly expressive at the international level. So in this context, my approaches are actually very narrow when it comes to the knowledge of the neglected issues of public international law. And we are not finding sound, international covenants which are actually addressing some of the issues and challenges of public, the IDP as such. So in this context, no matter, there are some root causes to resolve them: international humanitarian law, international criminal law, and guiding principles on the protection of internally displaced persons, 1998, are the root causes to understand IDP, internally displaced persons are concerned. So in this context, as and when you deal with internally displaced persons, of course, they are from our own places. They are not supposed to cross their international borders. If they want to cross their international borders, their ideologies might be different. They would be called as if refugees. See, as compared to internally displaced persons, refugees are well protected, you know very well, as far as Refugee Status Convention 1951 and the rest of them. Of course, UNHCR has been actually shouldered many responsibilities to protect, promote, and increase the human rights of refugees, but it is not so in the case of internally displaced persons are concerned. Internally displaced persons, they are highly vulnerable, retracted, and moreover, their issues and challenges are highly marginalized. That one has to understand. I'm just, running with some, you know, practical implications, where exactly the IDP has been actually threatened. It is because of some efforts made at the local level as such. So in this context, in fact, the conflict violations, then violence, and then the disasters and the other push factors are also quite common all over the world as such. In this context, as and when you deal with public international law, no matter, it is actually supranational, transnational, it is complementary, supplementary, and residuary to municipal law. Please understand. In 1988, we had a Bangalore Declaration. In that Bangalore Declaration, many statesmen, in fact, they gathered over here there to transfer such kind of international human rights law into the municipal law as such. See, international law is not an alien law. It is actually, complementary and supplementary to municipal law. That you have to understand. Kindly have a look on Article 253 of the Constitution of India, wherein it has outspoken on the principle of specific adoption as such. Of course, no doubt, there is a common misconception prevailed in Indian judicial system to the effect that international covenants are not supposed to be enforceable unless and until there shall be a specific legislation or an enactment. That is what we have known. Of course, thanks to higher judiciary, Supreme Court of India, in order to interpret international human rights law in an appropriate manner, ought to fill the gaps, especially country like India as such. This has come through with you to understand the entire area of the public international law as such. And it is actually theorized on the basis of treaties, customary laws, in which they are highly expressive under Article 38 of the Charter of ICJ 1946. And you have Vienna Convention on Law of Treaties, how it is actually directing you to frame certain, lawmaking treaty or treaty-making contracts. So these are the things that shall also be looked upon when it comes to the knowledge of the public international law as such. On the other hand, while you're actually dealing with the public international law, there are so many debatable issues. You know very well, Easternization and Westernization. Your Easternization has come through on the base of Islamic faith, whereas Westernization has come through on the base of Christianity. There also, you are not happily living. However, you are claiming to have oneness or unilateralism at the international level as such. Look at Eurocentric approach, US-centric approach, Asia-Afro-centric approach. I must share with you, being a student of a public international law, there is a need to understand, there is a need to understand cultural variables all over the world. That's what your J.S. Mill has emphasized. Your rights have come through on the basis of a value of utility. On the other hand, Karl von Savigny of Germany, Henry Meine of United Kingdom, they say that your rights have come through on the basis of cultural variables. That's why as many as a diversifications you do have. I agree with you. I'm not disputing it. See, isn't it? Many of them have defined on their own several linings. I agree with them. No matter. Look at in a sociological approach, Rousseau Pond categorized the interest of individual, public, and social interest. His guiding principle was actually one of the social engineering concepts. You have to understand. He makes us result-minded, cause-minded, process-minded. I must share with you, when it comes to the knowledge of protection of IDP, internally displaced persons, you should have all these directions. Otherwise, they'll be suffering like anything. And moreover, the women, children, the orphans would be highly targeted and they will have no voice. And you may say, you have to give voice to the voiceless. I agree with you philosophically. Look at India's position. Even today, we are not finding say, a single legislation which is actually dealing with the protection and preserve, the promotion of human rights of IDP in India, except Article 21 of the Constitution of India. No law is there. We have more than 7 lakh internally displaced persons. You have already been witnessed in J&K. 280,000 pundits, they actually migrated from Kashmir Valley to Jammu. Even today, their life is actually vulnerable. Please understand the situation, yeah, which is actually highly expressive at the national and the international level as such. That's why we need to have some, policies with a view to understand vulnerable sections of the society. And moreover, if rather you would say, displacement of persons is not a new concept in India. It was practiced in ancient India. For example, in the Mahabharata, the instances of mass, education from Kandava, Kandavan Vana, to build up, Indraprastha, a place near present Delhi, the capital of Pandavas. You have to understand. Look at during Sultanate era, also the shift of capital from Delhi to Daulatabad by Muhammad bin Tughlaq caused the displacement of many people who lost their livelihood and life as such. And moreover, since independence, internally displaced persons are found in India. The partition of India into India and Pakistan, civil disturbances occurred in India during such a time resulted in displacing of several persons from Pakistan and Bangladesh. This is one of the major issues and challenges of public international law. Look at the regional level, you have just, Kampala Convention that is actually restricted to African continent. Why can't in Asian countries, elsewhere in Latin America states, or else in European countries are concerned? That's why we need to have some regional integration with a view to understand these vulnerable groups, none other than IDP as such, internally displaced persons are concerned. Paradoxically, there are so many challenges are actually initiated when it comes to the knowledge of internally displaced persons are concerned. That's why in 1992, UN Secretary General Boutros Ghali, in fact, appointed Francis Deng to attend all these issues and challenges of IDP all over the world. In 1998, in fact, he came out with guiding principles on internally displaced persons. These are the basis with you to understand internally displaced persons all over the world as such. So according to guiding principles on internally displaced persons known as IDP, they are actually persons or groups of persons who have been actually forced or obliged to flee or to leave their homes or places of habitual residence, in particular as a result of or in order to avoid the effects of armed conflict, situations of a generalized violence, violations of human rights, or natural or man-made disasters, and who have not crossed an internationally recognized border. This is the exact definition in which these principles have already been outspoken. These principles were actually drafted by Mr. Francis M. Deng, who was actually appointed by the Secretary General of United Nations in 1992 as such. So See, these are the aspects shall also be looked upon. Now, the question comes into picture. How, not manner, public international law is actually responsible to pay for it, to understand these vulnerable groups are concerned. And you know very well, being a student of public international law, this law is actually flourished in aftermath of a Cold War, broadening in scope, deepening in content, and embracing a focus on individuals. So in this context, bringing international law into the 21st century is actually marvelous. That you have to understand. In thinking about international law, we should consider some of the trends. What are the trends you have? That you have to understand. The global economy is actually more interconnected than ever, more fluid and much more complex than ever before. Action or inaction in one country can have major repercussions in an increasing number of other countries or regions. The classic model for the development of international law is not always adopted or even adequate to this rapidly changing environment as such. So in contrast, I would say the negotiations of major international conventions and agreements is actually often slow and painful. This is what Professor rightly pointed out. And moreover, in some cases, it has come to a complete standstill. This is a huge challenge in these days. You have to understand why, where exactly you have failed in order to understand the metamorphosis development of the public international law, in which it has been rooted through on the basis of its own basis. That you have to understand. And moreover, the scope of international law is changing. It's evergreen, no matter however it could be. Although you have got some criticisms leveled against to UN Charter 1945. So unless and until you should have had UN Charter, how can you reach the peace in the world? That's why came forward with some action plan to understand peace and security at the international level as such. So lots of responsibilities are actually shouldered on United Nations organization to understand these vulnerable groups who have been actually left out in the society as a whole. So in this context, these global realities, the sectoral approach to the international law raises questions. For example, what areas need to be covered in the international law is a question of fact and law as well, that we have to understand in otherwise manner as such. Look at the statistics. We have had alarming statistics when it comes to the knowledge of IDP all over the world as such. They have scattered like anything throughout the world, and they're not finding some specific legislations which could be addressed accordingly. I have come across with some statistics through which you can understand where exactly the IDP, they have been actually facing a lot of problems. All over the world, we are witnessing more than 6 million refugees, 50 million internally displaced persons. In Syria, you can find 7.6 million, Cambodia, 6 million, Iraq, 3.6 million, Democratic Republic of Congo, 2.8 million, in Sudan, 2.2 million, South Sudan, 1.9 million, Nigeria, 1.2 million, Pakistan, 1.4 million, Somalia, 1.1 million. So likewise, you have been talking on many, many issues, challenges of these refugees, IDP are concerned. This is what the International Rescue Committee has already been assessed the countries at a great risk of a humanitarian crisis in 2020 as such. That you have to understand. The conflict and instability in the Central Africa, African Republic, continue to drive displacement and food insecurity. At 2.6 million people, more than half of the country's population require, you know, humanitarian assistance, especially in CAR. You have to understand. Look at in Somalia, has been persistent instability and conflict since 1991. More than 5 million Somalis, I mean, over 40% of the total population need some form of humanitarian assistance even today. On the other hand, when you look from the perspective of a few other countries, take for an example, Venezuela, Nigeria, they're really vulnerable. I agree with you. No matter. We have given so many statistics to understand these. How long, where exactly you can find some routes to resolve these matters. These are actually ongoing here and there. But we need some solutions. How long you are going to study these subjects? We need to have some sound solutions. We need to have some conflict resolutions. Whether egg is first, hen is first, we don't know. Whether seed is first or plant is first, whether military necessity is first or humanity is first, we don't know. However, we have had some conflict resolutions. Through conflict resolutions, you have to work on. So that's one of the major observations we have. Look at more than half of the population of Syria has been actually displaced by conflict since 2011. The war has actually created 5.7 million refugees, 11 million Syrian, 65% of the population are in need of the humanitarian assistance. Who has to bail the cat? This is very, very important. You have to catch the cat and bail the cat. That's one of the major observations we have. If X happens, then Y ought to happen. If X commits a crime, you should be prosecuted accordingly. See, there is principle as it has been outspoken under the public international law, ad punere and ad dedere. No serious criminals shall not go unpunished. They should be prosecuted accordingly. That's what, you have already been established ICC. ICC has got jurisdiction on crimes against humanity, war crimes, genocide, peace, everything we have. We don't want to bring it to the notice of ICC. Why India is actually reluctant to accede Refugee Status Convention 1951 and Rome Statute 1998? Have you ever been spoken of till now? Isn't it? So that has to be looked upon. See, you have to show your interest at the international level. Otherwise, you would be victimized. Tomorrow, your own individuals are going to be blamed. So that's why it is the right time to sign or to ratify the Refugee Status Convention 1951 and the Rome Statute 1998. That's what I'm actually appealing all the statesmen to follow it accordingly. Otherwise, these problems would be continued till the end of your life. Simply, you have been actually talking in an otherwise manner. That's why we need to have some action plan as such. In this context, developing countries, very well, adopt many, many economic plans to improve their economy and compete in international market with developed countries. To achieve this, they initiate many development projects such as construction of dams, industrial areas, special economic zone. But sometimes the same development process will make people homeless. You have to understand. Internal displacement poses perhaps one of the most daunting humanitarian challenges of the world today. One of the fundamental factors
hampering a well-coordinated humanitarian response to internal displacement is often, you know, highly complex and fluid in nature of a displacement itself. That you have to understand. And moreover, if rather I would say, displacement remains a crucial, you know, and a critical factor of vulnerability for people across the world, in which I have already given you some statistics where exactly you are witnessing, you know, IDP all over the world as such. That's why the IDPs may be, you know, exposed to abuses, physical insecurity, and basic necessities of life and enjoyment of other rights are concerned. So in this context, addressing, of course, no doubt, this is one of the big challenges of a public international. You have to have some specific agreements or covenants at the international level to understand these, you know, the marginalized sections of the society as a whole. That's why Kofi Annan has emphasized in otherwise manner by saying that internal displacement is the greater tragedy of our time. The internally displaced people are among the most vulnerable of our human the family as such. They're all actually retracted from the society. And you talk many things on social and inclusive policies, exclusive policies. We can't be, you know, look on these people who are actually left out from the holistic or integrated society as a whole. And you know very well, there is no universal legally binding instrument equivalent to 1951 refugee status convention, at least for refugees. They do have their own protection. And moreover, UNHCR has been actually spending a lot of money for their survival, but it's not so in the case of internally displaced persons are concerned. That's why I'm actually raising this issue to have some specific covenants at the international level. As then, what is the state responsibility over here? And perhaps you may have gone through what is the responsibility, how, in what manner state responsibility shall be looked into when it comes to the knowledge of IDP as such. When a state violates international obligations, then the state responsibility would come into picture. This is what you have already been known on the basis of draft articles on state responsibility for wrongful acts, which were actually drafted by five special rapporteurs of International Law Commission in 2001. Since then, actually, we have been actually running with many, many thought-provoking issues on the concept of a state responsibility. The what kind of a kriya and karma you have when it comes to the knowledge of state responsibility assets. Kriya for yourself, karma for others. That you have to understand. We need to have, you know, dharma over here when you are actually running with these vulnerable groups who have been actually fleed their areas due to some, you know, issues on the challenges. It could be armed conflict. It could be based on the mega projects issued by the central or state governments. Tomorrow they'll say, yeah, go away from here. And they'll be vulnerable. So such being the case, you have to understand these issues, even from the perspective of their responsibilities of these states are concerned. All states, irrespective of the fact that they're all responsible when it comes to the knowledge of internal displaced persons all over the world as such. It could be in any manner. It could be an Eurocentric approach, US-centric approach, or as Asia-Afrocentric approach. You know very well, this is one of my hypothetical answers I'm just sharing with you. When you are closer to high temperature, high fertility will come. When you've got high fertility, population will be increased. When you've got population, these problems are quite common all over the world. So that's why you know, states are responsible to pay for it. State shall be the the protector of human rights. State shall not be the violator of human rights. That is what one has to understand on the basis of human values in which we have been actually running, not only in a national level, but also in an international level as such. So duty to protect, what does it mean? It deals with duty to respect, duty to protect, duty to fulfill the human rights obligations. Look at the very preamble of our UN Charter 1945. It starts with we, the people of the United Nations, determined to save the succeeding generation from the scourge of war. And it urges that there shall be international cooperation and mutual coexistence with a view to promote and encourage human rights and fundamental freedoms without distinction with race, sex, language, and religion. What else you need? Or legislations at the international level, you may be wondered. So that's why have a look at the human rights are concerned. That has to be looked into. And moreover, as you already been known, before the coming into force of all these legislations, I mean to say UN Charter 1945, or it's actually half century enactments, individuals had to be called as if were charters. Now individuals are accountable to the public international law as well. That you have to understand, and you have to fulfill the obligations of the individuals. Otherwise, the very purpose of the individualistic approach would be undermined. This is what V.R. Krishnayyar has already been emphasized in many, many platforms. What he says, access to justice is one among human rights. Even in otherwise manner, former chairperson of NHRC, Justice Anand, said that poverty that itself is a violation of human rights. Poverty that is there everywhere, even in Mahabharata, Ashwatthama used to drink milk, milk powder rather than real milk. Even in Ramayana, perhaps you might have witnessed when Shabari met Rama. She did not find, North Indian or South Indian food. She, gave wild fruits to Rama and worship. This is there, they everywhere. Even after 100 years, you are going to talk on poverty as such. So first of all, you have to understand the culture of human being. This is very, very important from the point of view of understanding the culture of the human being all along. And that's why you are Henri Manet and Carl von Zweigne. They say that your rights have come through on the basis of cultural variables. Cultural variables that you have to understand with a view to reach out the expectations of these the people who are actually highly marginalized at the international level as such. On the other hand, when you are actually dealing with the LPG system in which WTO has come across with some standards, I agree with you. In 1986, perhaps you might have gone through, General Assembly resolution, came out with some concrete solution to understand right to development. What is right to development? How in what manner right to development shall be looked upon at the international level? This is one of the observations we have. And moreover, especially in 1960 and 1970, there was an awareness among these developing countries could start. That's why, Group 77 countries, professor has already been emphasized on Group 77 countries, how in what manner Group 77 countries came across with a new international economic order, how new international economic order is actually helpful to shape the world at large. And moreover, if rather I would say, in these days, the new international economic order is actually misused and abused. And moreover, majority of the states are not relying on the developments that were actually taken place through new international economic order as such. Even today, Group 77 countries are actually debating with developed countries are concerned. You know very well, when you got money, you are going to exploit somebody. If you don't have any money, you will be exploited by somebody else. That is an order of the day, I do agree, shared to the people who are left out in the society as such. So in this context, no matter however it could be, the way in which these people are actually enjoying some rights shall also be looked upon at the international level as such. See, there are some root causes to protect the rights of IDP. Look at, you have, you know, Geneva Conventions, 1949, additional protocols you have. Then Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court we have. Then African Union, a convention for the protection and assistance of Internet Convention 2009. These are the few conventions which are actually relying on internally displaced persons. Of course, these guiding principles have already been outspoken on the protection and promotion of rights of internally displaced person. Kindly have a look on. In fact, these guidelines, identify rights and guarantees relevant to protection, the full equality. And if something has gone wrong, like, you know, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, you know very well, Article 6, 7, and 8 of Rome Statute 1998, they have outspoken on genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes, through which you can bring it to the notice of ICC if something has gone wrong to, you know, IDP. Internally displaced persons are concerned. Perhaps we may have gone through two main interesting cases decided by ICC very recently. Prosecutor versus Lebanga and prosecutor versus Bemba. These were the interesting cases which were actually responsible for the mass atrocities. This could happen, especially in the Republic of Congo as such. So thanks to ICC in actually resolving all these matters on the basis of the universal jurisdiction as such. The universal jurisdiction has come through on the basis of Rome Statute 1998 as such. So in this context, spoken on the humanitarian law also. That has to be looked upon as and when you are actually emphasizing on the rights of IDP all along. And apart from this, you have to understand some of the philosophical foundations in which they have outspoken under the umbrella of international humanitarian law. Look at rule of humanity has to be looked upon. On the other hand, the dictate of public consciousness, which was actually emphasized by the Martin's classes, shall also be found to be correct with you to understand the problems of IDP, even during armed conflict as such. Humanity shall be sustained during war situation, and they are not supposed to be, retracted from the society as well. And apart from these conventional mechanisms, you have customary law. Of course, I have come across with some hypothesis with a view to understand IDP all over the world. You know very well, displacement is a political and social problem. This has been actually witnessed in a country like India. You go to, Northeast JNU, even in some places, Karnataka, the primitive tribals have, based on 73rd and 74th Amendment, they have got all these participations. However, they have been actually ignored at the local level as such. This is one of the debatable issues we have a country like India as such. Strengthening its institutional capacity is not helpful to overcome. And moreover, very well, comprehensive national policy for IDPs in consultation with the displaced person, NGOs and intergovernmental organizations are not at all possible even today. So that's why we need to give some active participation of these IDP, NGOs and intergovernmental organizations are concerned, through which we can overcome some of the issues and challenges of these IDP are concerned. Then there shall be proper enforcement mechanisms. And you have to retain these guiding principles into the municipal law as such. There is a lot of scope to retain such kind of guiding principles into the municipal law as such. However, as many as policymakers, they say that these guiding principles are nothing but a soft laws. Soft law, they are not at all, you know, hard legislation. That's why they say these are the as many as safe corner statements are, issues and challenges we have when it comes to the knowledge of these. And on the other hand, I have come across some statements. Kindly have a look on. Insufficient legal regime governing such persons are there. And moreover, guiding principles take a very broad approach to displacement. And moreover, they have come through on the basis of certain developments that were actually taken place, especially UDHR, in UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, 1966, then International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, 1966. They are, in fact, general in character. So they are actually nowhere particular in order to understand the problems of these vulnerable groups are concerned. And moreover, especially in the armed conflict and communal or ethnic violence, they are all actually quite common. We need to have some sound solutions are concerned. And moreover, matter of policy. Of a national interest issues and challenges of IDP, country like India also. And moreover, entitled to full, civil, political, economic, social, cultural rights, in which you have already been gone through under the umbrella of, international human rights law. In international human rights law, you have had bundle of rights, but it's not so in the case of IHL. IHL is running with the duties of these belligerent states are concerned, that you have to balance the interest between international human rights law and humanitarian law as such. And moreover, it is very difficult to estimate the total number of conflict and violence when it comes to the knowledge of problems of IDP all over the world. And you know very well, inadequacy of inadequately addressed by international humanitarian response is there. Very well, all Geneva conventions and additional protocols, they deal with rule of humanity and dictate of the public consciousness. I agree with you, no matter. However, the way in which these legislations I have spoken of at the international level are actually general in character. They are not directly addressing the issue of IDP. That's why I have gone through it as if one of the current issues of public international law in these days are concerned. When it comes to the knowledge of IDP, we do have some rhetoric questions. We have to have some perennial comprehensive or exchange questions to be answered at the international level. Look at when you are actually researching on IDP, first of all, you have to have all these queries through which you can get into either it could be a doctrinal or non-doctrinal, deductive or inductive, qualitative or quantitative researchers. So I must share with you, when you're actually addressing these issues of great relevance, you have to have these questions. Which group can be considered as internally displaceable? How, in what manner you are going to distinguish between internally displaced persons and refugees are concerned? You cannot mix accordingly. So they are actually different from different perspectives are concerned, and their entitlements also, you have to understand. Is there any difference between refugees and internally displaced persons? That you have to understand. What are the reasons for displacement? And who is responsible for protection of displaced? whether displacement should be limited only to conflict situation or otherwise. You have to understand what are the remedies available to the displaced persons, which law is applicable to protect internal displaced persons, are they legally protected or not. You have to have some rhetoric questions. These are the few questions which shall be looked. And moreover, there are some issues involved, and you can find some causes within the guiding principles. These guiding principles are having gone through on, you know, armed conflict, a situation of generalized violation, human rights violations, national and man-made disasters are concerned. When the problem was actually widespread all over the world, as I said in earlier slides, Boutros Ghali, in fact, appointed Mr. Francis Deng of Sudan to understand the problems of IDP all over the world as such. So that's why they were actually neglected. We need to understand these problems of IDP. He went through these guiding principles are concerned. These guiding principles are actually relying on armed conflict situation of generalized violence, human rights violations, for example, natural or man-made disasters are concerned. These are the roots we have to understand. And moreover, guiding principles cover all the phases of displacement. You have to go through them. And you know very well, as and when you deal with IDP, so then you shall not be forgotten on their family separation, loss of documentation, freedom of movement in or out of camps, and a loss of property is actually quite common all along. So that's why we need to have some specific developments which could be helpful for these vulnerable groups are concerned. And moreover, perhaps you may have gone through some general conventions which are actually dealing with the human rights protection. They could be, as I said, UDHR, ICCPR, International Covenant on Economic and Social and Cultural Rights 1966. We have, Beijing Declaration, Vienna Action Plan. All in all, actually, are actually helping these vulnerable groups are concerned. In absence of hard law, what shall be done? So that's why, soft laws have come through, none other than guiding principles on, protection of internally displaced persons are concerned. So in this context, I would say, being a human being, one has to understand where exactly you have come from, then only you appreciate where are you going. This is very, very important from the point of view of understanding these people. If somebody is actually crying at home, that the mother should know why he is actually crying. So likewise, if internet displaced person is actually crying, that the state should know why he is actually crying, what are his problems, should be looked upon. That you have to understand as and when you deal with these IDP are concerned. And on the other hand, when you're actually running with, conflicting interests between municipal law and the international law, of course, your work and all has already been directed. You have to understand work and all's approaches on public international law. What he says that a law is a spontaneous generation from the needs and aspirations of a man in community, though its specific details differ from time to time and from place to place, its most basic principles are actually uniform, because the human nature in its essence is actually constant, and therefore no unbridgeable gap between international law and municipal law. That's why the both systems are actually founded on the general principles of law, and they differ only in respect of the areas of human activities. That you have to understand. This is what Professor Raghunath Reddy sir has already been pointed out. He has gone through many, many steps. Look at it could be on conservation of the natural resources of seabed, subsand, ocean floor, or launching of some satellites into the orbit. This is what the air and space law has come through. We have to understand the economic crisis among the nations. International economic law has actually answered your queries or concern. No matter, self-consistent law is an illusion. There should be consistent with all disciplines. So in this context, public international law's approaches are wider and wider character that you have to understand. However, you might have got some criticisms leveled against public international law. Public international law is actually better than municipal nowadays. If rather, I would say, you might have got criticisms leveled against to these observations are concerned. And moreover, man is actually not confined to confined by the state, but lives his life within the community of mankind. This is what you have to understand, the common heritage of mankind, our common concern of humanity, which are highly expressive at the international level as such. And moreover, the moral obligation to sustain the common good of mankind is the origin of obligation to conform to the rules which regulate international behavior as such. So you have to regulate human behavior or states' behavior as well at the higher level as such. So in this context, while you're actually dealing with this, of course, you are not supposed to be limited to certain action. You have to have some legal entitlement to these groups are concerned. You know very well, in India, there are four broad categories of displacement. You have political causes, identity-based autonomy movements, localized violence, you have environmental and development-induced displacement. These are the quite common issues and challenges we have. I must share with you, state responsibility is paramount. That you have to understand. Have a look on draft articles on state responsibility for internationally wrongful acts 2001, which are actually giving you some thematic approaches to understand the concept of the state responsibility as such. And I must share with you, being a student of public international law, the entire civil society is responsible for the violation of human rights of internally displaced persons, not only in India, cutting across the world, in which I have already given you some statistics where exactly ongoing crises are actually being held at the international level as such. So in this context, philosophically, now one has to understand even from the point of view of the Immanuel Kant's approaches on ethics, what he maintains that persons typically have different desires and ends. So any principle derived from them can only be a contingent. That's what Immanuel Kant has outspoken on these issues and challenges. And on the other hand, John Rawls' approaches shall also be looked upon. That's what in a theory of justice, John Rawls expressed by saying that justice is the first virtue of the social institutions are concerned. That's why even V.R. Krishna has expressed in many, many cases, access to justice is actually one among the human rights. That has to be looked into with a view to understand these issues and challenges. Of course, no doubt, they are entitled to all these. Sometimes you cannot be suspended these rights. Some rights cannot be derogated, as you have already been understood. Even from the perspective of international human rights law, international humanitarian law, international criminal law, and guiding principles as well, that you had to understand. And status of guiding principles, when you are actually dealing with the status of the guiding principles, you can have all these questions through which you can have some fruitful answers. Otherwise, it would be virtually impossible to understand the problems. What is the status of guiding principle? How in what manner guiding principle is actually relying? Is it a law or not? What authority do they got they don't have any authority to decide what is to be done. You have to understand what is forced displacement. This is private. However, there are many instances where you can find a forced displacement all over the world. Especially in India, it's quite common. When you are actually relying on mega projects, look at Damodar Valley's project, Terry's project, Narmada, dam construction. Many people were actually, displaced due to all these mega projects issued by the central government as such. One has to look into the matter. Then forced displacement is quite common. So when you are actually dealing with this, from the analytical point of view, legal principles on, displacement are not actually binding. They're not at all binding. You should understand. Guiding principles on the IDP. The state authorities lack severely with proper planning and shifting the displaced person at the time of the displacement as such. Look at Rehabilitation Act in country, like India is actually squeezed like anything. It is because of some vested interest at the higher level as such. There is a gross violation of human rights. Of course, no doubt, when you are actually relying on IDP, women and children are going to be targeted. That's one of the major issues and challenges we have. The refugees and internally displaced persons are often confused. Sometimes when you are actually documenting, it's very difficult to identify who are actually refugees and internally displaced persons are concerned. And as you have already been known, based on these guiding principles, internally displaced persons are not supposed to cross their international borders, in which a refugee can cross. He has had his own protection at the international level, but it is not so in the case of IDP. That we have to understand. The state sovereignty is the principal obstacle. Very well, the supreme power of the state is one of the major hindrance to these groups are concerned. And forced displacement and the militarization of ethnic states are also quite common all along. They provide guidance to all this. You have to understand. There are some institutions which are actually dealing with the internal displacement. Thanks to International Committee of Red Cross, International Organization for Migration, then World Health Organization, United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, then United Nations Children's Emergency Fund, United Nations Development Program. These are the agencies who have been actually helping these vulnerable groups indirectly, not directly. Look at even UNHCR. UNHCR is not actually lending any money. They want to, with a view to identify refugees, they are conducting research. Please understand. This is one of the major challenges. You just go through UNHCR website, you will have known who will be actually protected under the umbrella of UNHCR assets. Very interesting. When I was actually dealing with some pieces of the research, I could be able to find out where exactly UNHCR is not actually helping these groups are concerned. This is one of the major issues and challenges we have. And what kind of mandates you have? See, my approach is very, very simple. Since it is one of the neglected areas of public international law, and this is one of the current challenges too, I agree. So that's why you have to raise some international awareness and advocacy through which you can overcome. Then promulgating international law, there shall be normative and institutional buildings through which you can overcome some of the issues and challenges of IDP. Then promoting an international institutional framework is very much required, and improving the knowledge-based system shall also be there. Ultimately, give an education to these people, that would be fine. That's what, even Swami Vivekananda has already been outspoken, isn't it? Our religion has taught us not only tolerance, but also acceptance that has to be looked upon on the basis of a righteous manner. that should be based on right to education, which is highly expressive under Article 21A of the Constitution of India as such. Being a student of public international law, when you are actually dealing with these two main issues and challenges like municipal law and international law, of course, they should go hand in hand. I'm not supposed to say you have to follow monism, isn't it? That's a different issue when you are actually relying on the, you know, municipal law and international law. There are so many theoretical observations I've spoken of, as you are already come across. It could be monism, dualism, specific adoption theory, delegation theory, incorporation theory, pluralistic theory, harmonious construction, all in all have come through. I agree with you. My concern is to retain such kind of international law into the municipal law as such. So in this context, you have to understand all these issues and challenges based on these areas of interest as such. If you have got some questions, I'll be able to give an answer. So thank you very much for giving this opportunity to share few thoughts on one of the neglected issues of the public international law, where states have actually failed in addressing these issues at the international level. However, United Nations organization has been actually running with many, many action plans to overcome some of the issues of IDP all over the world as such. You know very well, they are highly vulnerable, retracted, and marginalized in our society as such. That's why we need to have some action plans. And moreover, in the concluding remarks, states should ensure that the specific needs and fundamental rights shall be looked. You have to maintain an economic and social environment and criminalize arbitrary displacement. As I said, if X happens, then Y ought to happen. If X commits a crime, he should be prosecuted. So in this context, you have to understand the rules of humanity or dictate of public consciousness in which international humanitarian law has been actually outspoken at the higher level as such. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to share few thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Teachers affect eternity. No one can tell where their influence stops. In Tamil, Marudam means wind. Sometimes wind blows as a breeze. In Tamil, we call it as Thendral. Sometimes it may be violent winds. In Tamil, we call it as Thunder Marudam. Your wonderful lecture was also like that, sir. Combination of both breeze and storm. Really, your comprehensive lecture helped us understand the problem and legal lacunae in protection of 50.8 million internally displaced persons throughout the world, irrespective of continents and countries like Asian countries, Syria, Cambodia, African countries, Democratic Republic Congo, South Sudan, Nigeria, Somalia, and South American country, Venezuela, including our India also. Due to various reasons like development, civil war, ethnic war, constructions, industry, etc. Very thought-provoking lecture, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Due to lack of time, we are skipping the question and answer session now, but the questions of the audience will be collected and will be given to our resource persons. Over to Brinda ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Could you please stop sharing, Maruti sir? Please stop sharing. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Okay. Still, you have not done it, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
You have to stop sharing, sir.
Okay, 1 minute. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for your detailed and enlightening session, including widening progress of internally displaced persons provisions, sir. Thank you, Manu ma'am, for your wonderful moderation. And it was a pleasant evening with a much knowledge feeding session. Thus, we have come to end of today's national webinar on current challenges in international law. We believe every one of us have enjoyed this session. And now it's time to recognize the efforts and support rendered. To recognize and submit our gratitude, may I request Dr. V. Shyam Sundar sir, Assistant Professor and Co-Convener, to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you, Brinda Devi ma'am. It's a long, superb and perfect way of the international law webinar. A graceful and warm evening to everyone present here in this virtual meet. It is my privilege to propose this vote of thanks on behalf of our co-convener committee in this international webinar. I, on behalf of the committee, the entire fraternity of this college, first of all, I give most sincere thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor of Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University, our Professor Dr. N. S. Santoshkumar sir. Thank you, sir. I extend my very hearty thanks to our patron of this webinar and Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokalingam sir, for the great support to our college in all the occasions. I extend my very graceful thanks to Professor Dr. A. Vijayalakshmi Ramalingam ma'am. Ma'am, your felicitations is wonderful. You are the person who always encourages us in all the time. Whenever we are conducting any webinar, you will be the first person to come and greet our one of the principal. You are a come and greet our principal ma'am in a empathetic manner. You are one of the support to us ma'am. Thanks a lot ma'am. Thanks for your speech ma'am. I specifically thank our principal and convener madam. So one time Asha Bogle asked MS Dhoni, how you stump in you falsely you are stumping. That MS Dhoni told, no, that is not my part. The first thing is the bowler has to beat the batsman. The ball should be coming in my hand. So Asha Bogle tell, what is your outer? No, that is not. That is what my ma'am is also like that. So whatever she tells means it's a teamwork. It is always because she is only doing everything according to her directions and guidance only. We are doing everything, but she is the leader, really leader like MS Dhoni. She leads from us. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your encouraging support. That is what we are. Our college is in the first position, as Ramalingam ma'am told. Thank you, ma'am. The legend is always a legend. Both are two legends. Their inspiring speech in the international law, that is a wonderful thing. So our professor, Dr. A. Raghunath Reddy, sir, and our professor, Dr. T. R. Maruthi, sir, thanks a lot, sir, for your elaborate speech in this virtual webinar. I thank principals from other colleges, Professor Dr. Tangarmani, ma'am, Professor Jayagori, ma'am, Professor S. M. Balakrishnan, sir, Dr. Lata, ma'am, Jayagori, ma'am, and other faculties from the other colleges. Thanks a lot for everyone to be there. The teamwork is success of every program. That is what my principal has told always. So I acknowledge my sincere appreciation to our co-convener team headed by Mrs. C. Usha ma'am, Associate Professor, Mrs. V. Madhumita ma'am, Mrs. Brinda Devi ma'am, Mrs. S. Mano ma'am, and Dr. Jeevaratnam and Dr. Vadivelu. Connected in the virtual mode, without the technical team, we can't run this show smoother. I hereby wholeheartedly thank Mrs. C. Epsiba Pila ma'am and Mrs. D. Kritika ma'am for their effort. With their own and style idea of working nature, I mention my deepest sense of appreciation and good place, my record of hearty congratulations, thanks to both of them. I also extend my sincere thanks to our college faculties, Devi ma'am, Rekha ma'am, Subhas sir, my co-colleagues, Ramya ma'am, Arogyam sir, Yagani ma'am, Vijayashree ma'am, Janu ma'am, Ashok sir, our physical education director, Mr. Muthu sir, Swaminathan sir, and Begum ma'am for the always supportive and cooperative to all the way. I wish to state that we are very grateful to all the participants all over the India. Thanks, one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your vote of thanks, which was a complete one. And with this, we end the session. May I request one and all present here to rise for national anthem?
जन गण मन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव नव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे जन गण
Once again, I thank all the participants for joining us and making this event a wonderful one. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.